Hi, Stefan.
Hi, Liz. Great to see you.
You too. You spent 25 years in our institutional business before moving to our private wealth division. Can you give us a sense of your client base and their characteristics as investors?
Sure. Private wealth is by far the largest pool of capital around the world. It's estimated to be over $350 trillion in size. By comparison, hedge funds probably manage around 3 to 4 and private equity 5 to 6 trillion. And contrary to, say, fund managers, they don't face short-term performance pressure or redemptions, and therefore they're able to take a very long-term view. At the same time, they're able to be nimble and opportunistic about market opportunities, given they're not facing any particular constraints around accounting, capital, or regulations like institutional investors do. So flexible, yet often permanent long-term capital, as clients ultimately look to pass their wealth down to the next generation. This makes them a very interesting investor base for corporates and governments alike. Above all, I love to work with them, as it's a very diverse client base. All sorts of backgrounds, various generations, entrepreneurs who just IPO'd their companies to well-established families.
So just given some of these characteristics, flexibility, emphasis on long-term capital, how have your clients been approaching the markets during these times of unprecedented uncertainty?
Yeah, I would distinguish between three activities that our clients do. One, the business they're associated with. Two, their philanthropic activities. And three, the actual investment performance. If we start with the businesses that our clients are involved with, clearly, if you're in the, say, hospitality or traveling sector, you had a very tough time, and you often had to redeploy capital into these businesses. On the other hand, say, tech entrepreneurs did much better. What was really encouraging to see was that our clients were stepping up their philanthropic activities in recent months in a very meaningful way. We spend a lot of time advising our clients how to best make contributions to frontline organizations or charities that help communities who are suffering due to the pandemic. And in terms of investment performance, so far this crisis has been very different than the global financial crisis in 2008-2009. For a start, clients had a lot less leverage, and therefore there was less pressure to sell risky assets when the market sold off. We spent a huge amount of time helping our clients to understand what's going on and keep focused on the right long-term outcomes. Generally, I'm pleased to say that our clients stayed invested and hence benefited from a rebound in asset prices. Some actually even rebalanced at the end of March at the low of the equity markets and ended up adding stocks at very favorable levels.
But now it's getting even more difficult to invest with historically low interest rates and equities approaching record levels. How are your clients approaching the second half of the year?
Aside from the US election and other things that are top of mind for clients, I would highlight two broad themes. First, the shift from public to private markets, and second, ESG. If you look at the bond markets, 25% of all bonds globally have a negative yield. Worse, if you look at the so-called real yield, so adjusting the price for inflation, over 75% of bonds are estimated to be in negative territory. And in Europe, where this issue is particularly pronounced, more than 80% of corporates pay a higher dividend yield than what their corporate bonds are yielding. That's definitely not what I learned how markets are supposed to work. As a consequence, we're seeing clients shifting their attention further and further to private markets. Historically, our clients were most interested in private equity. Now they're looking at a much broader set of opportunities at the various parts of the private debt market. The other theme that is top of mind for our clients is socially responsible investing, or ESG, environmental, social, and governance. When the crisis hit, one of my personal worry was that clients would forget about ESG because they had to focus on some more short-term immediate needs. This has really not happened. In fact, we've seen a lot of clients wanting to do more. Naturally, the S, the social component in ESG, has become a focal point for our clients. but also particularly here in Europe where I'm based, the environmental aspect has seen a lot of interest given the exciting news around the European Green Deal.
So tell us more about that. The Green Deal is obviously a massive undertaking. How are clients thinking about it?
Clients focus on its size and scope, as the European Green Deal is an ambitious climate plan. It aims to fully decarbonize the European economy and achieve net zero emissions by 2050. We believe it's going to require investments of around 7 trillion euros, which is about $8 trillion over the next 30 years. It's equivalent to 40% of the European GDP. So it is a big focus for our clients.
So what are the implications of the deal from an investing perspective?
Look, there are really two folds. On one hand, just under half of these investments will likely be carried out by the private sector as energy companies make investments in renewables, power networks, and so on. This should unlock exciting investment opportunities for our clients and mitigate to some extent the issues that we historically had in ESG investments, that there was simply not enough supply. The other key factor is the regulatory part of the Green Deal, which has a profound impact on many industries. For us, it will change the way we advise clients, and with that, advisors will get a new job description. It goes beyond the E in ESG, as wealth managers need to integrate all ESG factors in all of their processes, from onboarding clients to advising them to making these investment decisions on their behalf. We think that's a good thing, as it helps anchor what is effectively an imperative for the world to better address environmental, social, and governance issues.
Thanks, Stefan.
Thanks, Liz, for having me. I hope to see you soon in person.
Me too.